Welcome to the Drum History Podcast. I'm your host, Bart Vanderzee, and today I'm joined by Nicholas D. Ball, the creator of drumsinthe20s.com. Nicholas, welcome to the show.
Hi, Bart. I've been listening a lot, so it's exciting to finally be inside and have a look around. I like what you've done with the place here. I'm a big fan, so it's a real pleasure.
Thank you. Yeah, you're on it, man. You're here. You obviously have this awesome website. You've got a deep passion for drums in the 20s, which is really a special like time period for drumming. You described it to me as this is a good way to frame this episode, and I think it's just wonderful. So we'll say this is today we're going to talk about the development of drum technology during the 20s, all the crazy inventions and innovations, which I think sort of parallels like today. I mean, even throughout all of history, there's these like crazy inventions coming up, but it really hit a lot in the 20s. And we're going to talk about some of the players, which you've got some special selected music for us.
I have.
That is new on the show, which I'm just super excited about.
Yeah, I mean, my specialism really is in jazz, ragtime and jazz, and the sort of development of popular music from the 1910s through to the 1920s and maybe early 30s. It seems, you know, of course, you know, as you say, that was an era which was replete with all sorts of fascinating and arcane developments in instrument technology, because, you know, we start out in the late 1910s as the jazz age begins with something that's really just a collection of marching band drums suddenly sort of assembled and played by one person. But, you know, it's hardly the drum kit as we'd recognize it today. But by the end of the decade, it really is starting to take shape, and all the bits you'd recognize, all the different component parts, are really starting to become standardized. And the way that they're being used is starting to become mainstream, so that, you know, that you can say there's definitely one way of playing the drum kit that's something slightly akin to what we'd recognize today. But really, to me, it always makes, you know, not so much sense to talk about instruments without hearing the way they were being used, because, you know, it's obviously a period where lots of people are interested in the developments in the gear, and it's easy to see photos. You know, we've got scans of catalogs from manufacturers, and you can Google or, you know, search for photos of old drum kits from the 20s or whatever, trap kits and consoles and all sorts of amazing gear like that. But often I have people writing in saying, I've just bought I found a console kit in a flea market. What do I do with it? How do I play it? You know, what should I be doing with it? And that's a journey that I had to go on myself, because I had a very similar experience. I got into this music by finding a drum kit in a junk shop here in London for about £15, which is, I don't know how much that is in dollars, but it's pretty cheap. So I just sort of bought it on the spot and thought, great, I've got this, you know, this vintage kit from the 19, I looked up, found that it was from the 1910s. And then found that I didn't know how to use it or what music it would have been played for, or, you know, anything like that. So I had to go on this massive kind of school project, which I've been on for 12 years or so, and I'm still on, really. But and the website that you mentioned is kind of the show and tell period for that, which is, you know, ongoing. And there's a fair bit up there already, but hopefully there'll be much more to come in the years to come as I kind of keep obsessively delving into this history and writing it up for everybody.
Yeah. I mean, it's, it's so cool how you just said, like, you know, you didn't like early on the drum set didn't really look like what we have today, because it was these pieces coming together. And then it sort of just like starts to appear like what we have today. And there's a thing with a lot of these episodes where it'll be like, it happened in multiple different countries at one, you know, in a relatively short time. So it's like, and ends up in this 20s, like, it's like the perfect timing. It was in the air, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
So really what I'm sort of mostly specializing in these days is trying to piece together what these drummers did, because, of course, the problem is, as I say, it's easy to look at a photo, it's easy to look at a catalogue and see what instruments were around and find old period examples of them. You know, of course, there are people who've made specialisms of that, and I don't really claim to be a great specialist in the minutiae of gear design and, you know, nuts and bolts and different lug shapes and all this sort of stuff. But what I have really studied a lot is the way that this gear was used in the music in real life. And the problem there, of course, is that means you have to deal a lot with old recordings, which are, you know, at the start of the jazz age in the late 1910s, we're talking about acoustic recording technology, you know, extremely limited amount of sonic range. You can't hear bass drums very clearly, you know, mm-hmm. and there's so much surface noise, and we're going to hear some musical examples in a short while, which, you know, it's over a century old. And if you'll allow me a slightly tortured analogy here, it's a bit like, we used to have a program here called a TV program called Time Team. I don't know if you ever had that over there, but no. It was basically a bunch of archaeologists who would go to a historical site and dig stuff up, and they'd pull something out, and it would just look like a lump of mud, you know, soil of some sort. And they'd be so excited about, oh, wow, look at this. And you'd be thinking, well, that doesn't look like anything. And then they'd wash it and, you know, clean it up and sort of piece it together. And, you know, it would turn out to be some ancient Roman vase or something that, okay, it was still knackered. You could see it was covered in dirt. There were bits chipped off it. But you could tell that there was something of incredible beauty underneath. And that was really interesting. Yeah.
You know, I think I have seen that on YouTube. It's a kind of a short guy, like a little bit balding with like...
That's the guy.
He's a host. Yeah. He also did like the deadliest jobs in...
Yes, Tony Robinson. He was on Blackadder. He was Baldrick in Blackadder, a great sitcom in the 80s. Anyhow, so listening to those old records, I mean, I know it's a ridiculous analogy, but for me, it's a little bit like that. You have to kind of hear through the crackle and the distortion and the poor quality, you know, particularly for these really early 20s and late 10s recordings. And there is good stuff going on underneath, but it just takes a bit of... I mean, some of these recordings that I'm going to play, I really do advise, if you found it hard or you weren't getting much out of it on the first listen, just wind the podcast back, you know, 30 seconds and listen to it two or three times. And I promise you, it really does. You do start to hear new things in it. So that's something that it's a skill that kind of you do have to become acclimatized to, really.
Sure. We all get used to the modern recordings and you take for granted, you know, hearing a bass drum really clearly. But like you said, there's just not that much. I mean, it was probably one microphone in the room or like a horn they're playing into like, you know, into the stylus, you know, that's a whole different thing. But
absolutely right.
So how do you want to proceed here with, let me know if we should be playing music or cue it up, or if you want to talk about the gear first, you know, whatever you would like to do.
Well, I think what we've already had, I mean, I've already heard a couple of excellent episodes about the silent film and theatre and pit drummers and traps and all that sort of stuff with all the bells and whistles and sound effects. And I mean, that's a whole other world, which I've kind of done a bit of and branched into a little bit, but I think you've covered that so excellently already.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm gonna sort of take us on a slightly, a parallel path that was going on around about the same time with obviously some of the same gear being used. But this is really, you know, what I mainly do, which is the jazz stuff, which of course at the time was probably the most hip and the most cutting edge popular music form around. And so maybe we're going to sort of look at really the story and the evolution of jazz drumming through the 20s, or from the very late 10s through to the late 20s, looking at some of the main players. And as we get to each new development in technology, maybe I'll sort of introduce that as we go.
Yeah.
And we can hear it being played, and we can also talk about it a bit.
That sounds
so
great.
If that's okay, we'll take a look at the way things were when the jazz age began, or just before, in the late 1910s. Of course, at this point, really the prevailing musical style was ragtime, which began, you know, sort of, I suppose, around about the turn of the century, 1900s. And really, by the time you get the first jazz band appearing, which is 1917, the first band to market itself as a jazz band, at least, a lot of the ingredients for what you think of as jazz were already present in sort of late period ragtime. And then you get these hybrid styles for a while, like jazz, which is a sort of precursor to jazz. They changed the spelling. Originally, it was jazz with two S's. And ragga jazz and all these different sort of monikers that were used for this type of music that was really a transitional genre from ragtime into jazz. The thing that ragtime didn't quite have, which came along with jazz, and really, I mean, there weren't recordings made down there, so we don't really know, but it seems like New Orleans was the epicenter for these other ingredients that weren't in ragtime, which is the sort of the blues element, which isn't really present in ragtime. Blue notes, bent notes, you know, slurs and growls and that sort of stuff. And also the sort of emphasis on brass and reed instruments, because ragtime, you know, there were small groups. I mean, people tend to think of ragtime as a piano-based music. And of course it was, you know, you got Scott Joplin and Joseph Lamb and all those guys. But there were also small bands playing ragtime, you know, quartets, quintets, you know, the perfect precursor to your modern jazz combo. In the late 1910s, playing this stuff, but it was all on banjos and violins and mostly string instruments, but they were drummers. And the drummers often played some of the most cutting edge stuff. They mostly improvised their parts. They weren't just reading. And they would play time, you know, mostly styles that was evolved from military band music. So it was mm-hmm. two beat music, you know, like with two strong beats in a bar, beat one and beat three, kind of like you'd have with a, you know, in a rock beat these days.
Sure.
Yeah. And so they'd be playing that on a bass drum, usually using some kind of pedal. Of course, the first, you know, modern, quote unquote, modern pedal came around in 1909, but there were yep. other ones as we've learned through listening to various episodes of your podcast. There were precursors to that with all sorts of crazy overhang designs and arcane stuff going on there.
Yeah.
Heath Robinson designs. But yes, they'd be playing the two beat feel on the bass drum, mostly playing time on the snare drum like you would in a military band, only of course they were making it much more syncopated and, you know, exciting, mm-hmm. playing all sorts of hip accents and you know, rudimentary stuff on the snare drum, and occasionally moving to a woodblock for a bit of variation, because the whole thing was to variate chorus to chorus depending on what instrument was taking the melody or you know, leading the tune. You'd play a different accompaniment, a different texture behind it. But unlike modern drumming, where you often would have, you know, you've got your right hand on a cymbal, you've got your left hand on the snare drum, usually, you know, this sort of thing, your hands are spread apart on different instruments. At this point, most of the time, the drummers would focus on one sound at a time. So you'd have both hands on the snare drum, next chorus, both hands on woodblock, because a different instrument's playing the melody. So maybe now we should hear a bit of how this would sound.
Yeah.
So this is a very early piece of jazz. Not the very first jazz record, which was made in January 1917, but this is from, I think, June 1917. And this is a band called Earl Fuller's famous jazz band. The drummer is John Lucas. And we're going to hear a bit of a tune called A Band Contest. He starts off playing some march-like sort of rhythms on a deep snare drum. You can hear it's a really deep, you know, deep snare drum with a calfskin head. Probably one of those single tension snare drums, you know, with the thumb screws yeah. underneath.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Proper sort of marching band type instrument. And then when they go to the verse of the song, he goes to woodblock and cowbells. You can hear him playing all these sort of trap sounds on woodblocks. And then the chorus comes back and he returns to the snare, and you can really hear the change of texture as the snare comes back in. So cool. Yeah, let's hear a bit of that. John Lucas with yeah. Earl Fuller's Jazz Band.
Here we go. Yeah, very neat. I love hearing how it, you know, you really appreciate it more when you have like a lead up to that, like you just gave us. Like, I love hearing the, how they were playing, you know, one instrument at a time, snare and then woodblock. And am I crazy or was there a little bit of a cymbal there towards the end?
There was. At the end, yeah, there was a big smash on a sort of probably quite a big, heavy cymbal. I mean, we're going to get onto cymbals in a short while, but yeah, well spotted. Absolutely. Yeah, there was a cymbal crash in there too. That's why I left that on, just didn't fade it out earlier because I thought it was worth just hearing. Yeah, there probably was one cymbal there. Often they screwed the cymbals directly to the shell of the bass drum and just smashed it.
Yeah, yeah,
it wasn't subtle.
No, you don't want to do it all the time, and you're not doing I mean, but still, it's very good drumming. It's very military, like you said.
It is,
you know,
but it's also got a kind of Yeah, it's also got almost a kind of a rocky type energy to it. You know, it's very full on. There's no messing about.
No, I was headbanging that entire time.
Yeah, it is. I love that about it. It's almost like punk rock. And I think if you were around at the time, it would have been mind-blowingly hip and exciting. You know, you wouldn't have heard anything like that ever before. So it's no wonder that, you know, people went absolutely a bundle on all this stuff.
No, definitely.
Okay, so we've got some kind of very, very, very early dawn of the jazz age jazz there. So we now run into a bit of a problem because it seems like from 1921 onwards, round about then, there seems to have been implemented by recording engineers sort of an unofficial ban on drummers using full kit in the studio. The thinking being apparently that it would interfere with the vibrations of the cutter, you know what I mean, and overload also distort the recording. Now, we've just heard snare drum being played really loudly and it, you know, didn't seem to have any problem. And on the ODJB, which was the very first jazz band that recorded a couple of months before what we just heard, Tony Sbarbaro, who's the drummer in that band, he's playing double drumming on his bass drum and he's pounding away with the pedal and it doesn't seem to be any problem at all. But for some reason, from 1921 until about 1924, 5, 6, round about then, depending on which label we're talking about and which studio, drummers were restricted to using usually only woodblock, maybe a cowbell, maybe a cymbal.
I would think that like it would be more effective. I mean, obviously this is super early, but it's like, okay, first off, we'll separate things a little bit more, put it on some sort of a floating, you know, like floor where there's some space. And I would think that like bass, upright bass or something, as we all know, these low notes are really what rumble and shake things up.
Or tuba even more. A lot of these bands were using tuba as the bass instrument. Yeah. So
yeah, ban the tuba, not the drums.
Well, yeah, I think maybe it was the kind of vibrations of the feet pounding, because a lot of these pedals, remember, weren't excellent designs yet. You know, we're still kind of on the way towards your modern DW bass drum pedal. So perhaps they needed quite a lot of welly to get them going, and that maybe that shook the floor. I'm not sure, but anyhow, so we're confronted with this recording ban. So for the next 4 or 5 years, all the drums you'll hear on records are what I call recording traps. So like I say, woodblocks, cowbells, cymbals, which is a real shame because, of course, it means that we have less information about what these drummers would have played live, right? Which is a real drawback. Yeah. And, I mean, of course, you can conjecture and you can look at sheet music because, of course, there was published sheet music for bands, you know, local bands playing, even professional ones, where there are written out drum parts because even this early there was drum notation, you know, for kit. So you can see what they would have done live, but there's no evidence on recordings. So, you know, you have to do a little bit of kind of reading in between the lines and a bit of educated guesswork about what might have happened on these records. Yeah. But nevertheless, there was quite a bit of interesting stuff recorded. So we can hear maybe a bit of recording traps now. This is an unknown drummer who I can't find any information about who this was, but he's playing some recording traps and woodblock and cowbell, playing some kind of 3/2, almost like sort of what I call ragtime clave rhythms, which is that bucket, 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 you know, that sort of thing. This is the Synco Jazz Band, May 1922. We can hear some early 20s recording traps.
Cool. Here we go. Hot Lips. Nice. There's that cymbal at the end there. Almost sounded like a cymbal mute kind of.
Yeah. I think, a lot of the time you have to remember also that a lot of the frequencies are being lost with the cymbals as well. Like a lot of the cymbals sound incredibly dull and, you know, kind of like you hear the low frequencies, but you don't hear any of the kind of the shimmer on the top. So I don't know whether that was just, you know what I mean? Because it's early recording technology. Is that just what it did to a nice sounding cymbal? And, you know, we just hear the kind of the nasty overtones or not. It's hard to say. But certainly we're going to, like I say, we're going to get onto cymbals in a very short while.
My only other thought with that too, is it's very, like, so this is 1922. It's very trap. You know, it's very, I have that silent movie drummer feel. It's such a shame that they almost limited them by not letting them use a full kit, because it falls more into that. You know,
but in a way, it makes some interesting challenges for us drummers trying to reinterpret. In fact, I've just literally last week we released an album which we made back in 2019, but it's finally come out, which is called The King Oliver Project, where we took some recordings by King Oliver, who was a great, probably heard of, a great cornet player, who was born in New Orleans, recorded in Chicago in the early 20s. In fact, he recorded, his first record was made the year after the one we've just heard. And Baby Dodds on that record, again, is playing recording traps. But because we were recording it now, we transcribed a lot of King Oliver's records and stuff. And so we made the decision, oh, let's try and record it how it might have sounded live. So, of course, I used, you know, 28-inch bass drum, snare drum, everything else, and tried to kind of retrofit almost what Baby Dodds might have played live, knowing what he sounded like later in the decade. And I'm not the only one to do this. You know, I'm sure lots of other drummers who are specialists in this have done similar projects in the past. So, it brings its own challenges.
Yeah, we'll share that in the show notes so people can hear it and check it out and support you and all that good stuff.
Oh, well, that'd be nice too. So we've heard what that's like. So maybe in a possible attempt to circumvent the ban on recording full kit, there were a number of kind of crazes for novelty instruments around this time. Some of these were prompted by manufacturers who came up with, you know, new designs for sort of novelty instruments, some of which worked better than others and were adopted, you know, widespread. Others could have died out after, you know, a year or two. But the first one of these that we're going to look at, kind of novelty percussion instruments, wasn't actually manufactured at all. It was just something that somebody picked up and thought, hey, you know, I can use this. I can play rhythms on this. I can make an interesting sound. And that is the washboard. In 1923, a drummer called Jasper Taylor, who had a fantastic and incredibly colourful and vibrant life. We're probably not going to get time to go too deeply into biographical details here for any of these artists, but if you're interested, he is one of the most had one of the most colourful lives out of all of these drummers, and he's one of my early heroes that I wrote about on drums in the 20s because he was in the Wild West, he was in World War One, he was all over the shop. He had an incredible life. And he found a washboard on he said it was on a wood pile somewhere down south when he was playing with W.C. Handy's band. And the first time I think he used it on a record was with Jelly Roll Morton, who was a great New Orleans piano player, in 1923. And very quickly there was this craze because, you know, other drummers being like, what is that amazing sound? He's getting scraping sounds and he's sort of tapping different areas of the washboard and getting all these different kind of resonant pitches. And he was one of the first drummers to really do this, or certainly was the first to play washboard, but he was also one of the first to play featured choruses of solo. You don't really get solos on drums this early, but you do get choruses of breaks, you know, where the band plays break, break or whatever. So, you know, they play stabs really, and he plays plays these improvised breaks. And so really quickly after this, these records became a huge hit. We're actually going to hear him with the clarinet player, Jimmie O'Bryant, who's a bit of a forgotten figure, but they made a lot of records with this band, playing this kind of earthy, rustic, country-influenced jazz, mostly with piano, clarinet, and washboard. Strange lineup, but it really sold. Yeah. And people went wild for this stuff. So yeah, 1923, 24, 25, you get this big washboard craze. Other drummers that did this were Jimmie Bertrand, Floyd Campbell, Buddy Burton. There are a few others, even Baby Dodds. And what they would do, these guys, is put thimbles on their fingers and then scrape these washboards and tap them in all sorts of interesting ways. They all had their own styles, but Jasper Taylor was the originator of the jazz washboard. So I think perhaps we should hear a bit of him because he came first. And this is the Washboard Blues from 1925. Thank you.
Man, that's awesome. I would have guessed that is someone tap dancing. If you told me that was a the recording, I would have said, oh, they recorded someone tap dancing, you know, like just totally guessing.
Yeah. No, awesome. I mean, you wouldn't be far wrong. It was a lot of these drummers did start out as tap dancers.
Sure.
And in fact, Jasper Taylor was one. He was a tap dancer in this Wild West show when he was a teenager. So you're absolutely on the money with that, in fact, there, Bart. Yeah. And it's, yeah, using a lot of the same things. But of course, what you can't do with tap dancing is that scrape, that, you know, you can hear him tapping. So, So there was, like I say, I mean, these are broad trends. They're not, it's not to say everyone immediately rushed out and found themselves a washboard, but, you know, it was certainly something that you suddenly hear lots of people doing in the mid 20s, particularly black drummers on the south side of Chicago, which is where there was this big scene. That's where Jasper was based and a lot of the other guys that I mentioned earlier.
Cool.
Right. So now let's talk about cymbals, because I mean, all of us drummers, we all love cymbals. You know, it's probably the one subject, maybe along with snare drums, that you get a bunch of drummers talking about cymbals. You could be there, you know, for hours and hours. The cymbals, as we've talked a little bit about before, you know, the early guys in the early 20s, those cymbals, they don't sound great, do they? They sound quite kind of dull and kind of heavy. That's because they were, you know, a lot of these cymbals. I think I was listening to the episode with, who was it? I think it might have been with Rob Cook, your episode about hi-hats and sock cymbals and stuff.
And, yeah, Skip Rutherford and
yeah,
and all, that,
all about but, that stuff. And Rob mentioned about how these cymbals, you know, in the early 20s, they were the only ones you could get, certainly in terms of Turkish-style cymbals, because, of course, Chinese-style cymbals is another whole thing. The only ones you could really get in the early 20s were designed for marching band. You know, they were marching band instruments. You buy them in pairs, and they were designed to be portable, but also to project a lot. So they were kind of smallish diameters, but heavy as you like, you know, to mm-hmm. really resound. And that's mostly what these guys would have been using. Mostly, I suppose, imported from Turkey. Obviously, you know, you've got old Ks and stuff, but also lots of other brands that, you know, individual workshops and cymbal smiths working away in Constantinople and pumping them out and being imported to America. But not with a lot of quality control. So really, it was probably, you know, whatever your local music shop has, that's what you do. They would be hung on a hanger, you know, with like a sort of like a mini crane thing. A lot of them were clamped to the bass drum hoop. Then you'd have a vertical post, maybe a foot or so long, and then another post going off at a right angle from that with a sort of hook on the end. And then the cymbal would be suspended on a leather thong thing, sort of knotted like the kind of cymbals that you'd clash together in an orchestral.
Yeah.
You know, symphony orchestra.
Really?
And they'd just be hung off of that thing and you just, you know, smack it one, basically, with your drumstick.
Towards the end of the song, just smack it.
Yeah, basically. And for the first few years in the 20s, like we've heard, the drummers would just strike them, let them ring, and that was it. You know, there was no kind of more complicated technique involved than that. But around about 1922, 23, you suddenly get drummers choking their cymbals in a rhythmic way and playing rather than just striking the cymbal once every, you know, at the end of every chorus. Oh, you know, we've got to a dramatic moment. Smash. There you go. Playing rhythm and playing time and using the cymbal as a timekeeping device. Cause up until now, as we've heard, it's just been snare drum and woodblock or occasionally a novelty instrument like your woodblock, like your washboard. So yeah, 1923 onwards, really you get drummers playing, you know, keeping one hand underneath the cymbal so that it's choked, and playing all sorts of different rhythms, but, you know, staying on that, on the cymbal for a whole chorus, maybe. You might say, okay, trumpet solo, right, I'm going to play my choke cymbal behind that. One of the wonderful things about cymbals, of course, is they're so personal and distinctive. Everybody has their own cymbal sound and agonizes over, you know, what their ideal cymbal sound is and how can I best get that and everything, not only in the instruments, but in the way they're striking it, you know, the amount of sustain, the amount of touch on the cymbal and all this sort of stuff. So this is where we can really start to hear the personalities, the musical personalities of all these different drummers starting to come out. So what we're going to do is now I think we're going to hear one of the undoubted masters of 20s drumming, probably the big boy of 20s drumming, Baby Dodds, Warren Dodds. And we're going to hear him playing with Louis Armstrong, another person that perhaps everyone should have heard of. Yeah, big name. And this is from May 1927. So this is Louis' Hot 7. And the tune's Willie the Weeper. And we're going to hear the way Baby Dodds is playing the choke cymbal behind Louis' solo. And what I really want people to listen to is the character of the cymbal itself. You know, what kind of cymbal is it? You know, how big do you think it is? How heavy do you think it is? And also the amount of sustain that Baby's allowing. How long is he allowing the cymbal to ring for? How hard is he striking it? All this sort of stuff. Okay, let's have a listen to this.
All right. Very nice.
Yeah. So you see what I mean? He's really using it as a timekeeping device, not just a, you know, for one strike and at a big moment. It's regular time being played.
Yeah. It makes you bob your head.
Yeah. Well, this is dance music. You know, it's dance music. It's designed to get a floor full of people up on their feet dancing around, you know, for hours and hours at a time. And there wasn't, you know, there weren't amplifiers, there weren't microphones in dance halls yet. So really, if you wanted to swing a band and get a room of people dancing, you know, you needed a large-ish heavy cymbal. I think you hopefully would agree that's what that is.
Yes, sure.
Now, by now, we've got electric recording coming in, so you can hear the cymbals a little bit. You can hear the top end, you know, the kind of the sparkle and the ring at the top end of the cymbal a little bit more now. But yeah, so he's, you know, really playing some pounding time on there. And that's very much, you know, in his style. That's the way he played. And this is really the first, I mean, that not that particular recording, but Baby Dodds himself was one of the first people to really ride on a cymbal in that way. But of course, it's not riding on an open cymbal with the tip of the stick like we're used to, you know, in later styles of jazz, bebop and everything else. You know, you're striking the cymbal with the shoulder of the stick pretty hard and choking it with your other hand, with your, you know, your left hand if you're right-handed.
Yeah, you would see videos and recordings of like some of the like 40s guys, 30s guys doing this similar technique, but mixing it in with more like, you know, what we would consider traditional, like, you know, jazz drumming or drum solos. You'd see them do that kind of like, they almost like lean across the cymbal a little bit and kind of choke it or do it to the hi-hat too. So it's definitely a holdover from that 20s period.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've got, that's Baby's style, you know, kind of direct and powerful. And kind of very, with quite a resonant, you know, he allows quite a bit of sustain. It's not choked straight off. It's quite.
Yeah.
Let's hear how somebody else did it the same year. That was recorded in Chicago. We're now going to go over to New York the same year and hear the great Vic Berton, who was a kind of a session guy and percussionist and, you know, all round maestro. And he's playing with Red Nichols and his Five Pennies over in New York. And listen to the difference in the way Vic's doing it.
Okay, here we go.
Love that break.
Yeah.
There's a bit of woodblock in there too. I thought I'd leave that.
Yeah. Yeah, that is just the back and forth of the. It's still kind of the one instrument of the at a time sort of feel, but I guess we're not really hearing as much bass drum because of the recording. You know,
correct
the quality at the time, but really cool. Love that.
Yeah, I mean, he's playing. There's a lot more notes in there. He's a lot more kind of tricky and chopsy, isn't he? Than what
yes,
Baby was
he
doing.
Is. Yeah,
he also had this technique which we call the tricky cymbal technique, where he's playing the underside of the cymbal with the stick that he's muting the cymbal with his left hand, if you see what I mean. So
yeah,
whilst also muting this, choking the cymbal with his left hand, he's also playing the underside of it with a stick with two of his fingers. So he's able to play two sticks at once on a choked sounding cymbal, which was like mind blowing for people at the time. You could hear it a little bit in behind the, I think it was behind Adrian Rollini's bass sax solo, which was the second solo. You could hear there was a bit of which he does, you know, sort of all these kind of like drags and roughs and things with two sticks, you know, rudiments played. On cymbal. So that's Vic's whole thing. He's, I mean, such a different approach. And there were, obviously, I could have chosen so many other drummers that each had their own style as well. But I just thought those two were nicely, you know, different to each other to give an idea that, you know, there's not yet one way of doing things, and lots of people are interpreting it in their own way.
Yeah, they're not, one's not better than the other. One is more, I mean, it's just like, it's like the different tool in your tool belt for each situation, where one's going to, like Baby Dodds was way more straightforward, just, you know, timekeeping. But what Vic Berton did there was just very, I mean, that was flashy, you know?
Yes. Flashy is a perfect word for it. Yeah. You're absolutely right there, Bart. Yeah. He was one of the first drummers to be really featured as kind of an equal with the other members of the band. I mean, all those guys in that band were kind of, you know, it was almost like a who's who of hot New York jazz, you know, the sort of the best guys on the scene at the time in that city. Cool. And he would be mentioned right up there with all the others. You know, you've got Arthur Shutt on the piano, you've got Jimmie Dorsey on reeds or whoever, Red Nichols on trumpet, and Vic Berton on drums. You know, he would say, if you saw that on a record, you'd buy the record because he was a star in as much as a drummer could be at that time.
We're going to take a quick break, and I want to welcome a new sponsor on the show who's coming on board to support drum history and help make it even better. Dream Cymbals. Dream Cymbals creates B20 and truly hand-hammered cymbals for today's working drummer. Each handcrafted cymbal has a warmth that draws you in at low volumes, yet thunders with beautiful overtones when leaned into and opened up. These cymbals come alive with an explosive attack, but have undertones that are warm, rich, and dark. Each one has a unique, complex voice that will help you define your personal sound. The cymbals speak clearly at all dynamic levels and sit comfortably and easily blend in any mix. Head over to dreamcymbals.com or at dreamcymbals on Instagram and find out what your dream sounds like today. Now, back to a look at 1920s drummers.
So let's move on a bit and think about snare drums and the way snare drums were played. Because, you know, we heard a bit very early on with those kind of snapper, you know, that was one of the models at the time was the snapper, these single, you know, single tension drums with the thumb screws underneath. By the time you get to sort of 1923-24, particularly Leedy and then lots of other companies copying them are really bringing in these much more, you know, modern to our eyes, acceptable and kind of familiar dual tension snare drums with, you know, tuned with tuning bolts rather than with those crazy thumb screws that you tune with a drum key that have got separate tension for batter head and the resonant head. So you can, you know, and adjustable snares and everything like that. So it's really a much more recognizable modern snare drum. And all the cutting edge drummers, you know, by the mid-20s really were using these. Certainly Burton would have been in, and probably Baby as well, I think, by then. So what do people play on them? We've heard the early 20s style, which is much more sort of military and with lots of rudiments. By the middle of the decade, it seems like mostly led by the drummers who'd come up from New Orleans at the start of the decade that were now all in Chicago, because, of course, that's where the recording industry was. There wasn't really any recording in New Orleans until the middle of the decade. And a lot of these guys like Paul Barberin, Baby, we've mentioned, Zutty Singleton as well, developed this style of keeping time on snare drum where you'd play four beats with one stick, keeping, you know, all four quarter notes, and with the other stick, you'd play press rolls. So you'd play like a crushed, you know, a buzz roll on beat two and four. So you'd be playing, you know, dun, 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 that kind of thing, whilst keeping usually two beats on the bass drum still. No one knows really who originated this, but Baby and Paul Barberin and Zutty, as I say, are kind of the three main guys who, and maybe Tubby Hall as well. There's more about all this on the website, but yeah, you can.
That's very New Orleans.
Yeah, and that becomes really popular throughout the middle of the decade. So quite soon, everyone's doing that, whether you were born in New Orleans or not. You know, it's spread to New York, it's spread all over. And at the same time, you've got brushes becoming really established as a thing. Often the brushes are started out as being fly swatters. You know, there were these wire fly swatters that people would use with retractable wires that you could pull back into the handle. The first use of them on record that I found is the great Chauncey Morehouse, who was a drummer from, I think he was from New England, but he made a record in 1923, and I think that's the first time I've heard them on a record. I'm happy to be proved wrong, but I think that's around about the time they started really becoming popular. And what drummers would use the brushes for is usually similar to what they would play with the press rolls, only obviously a bit quieter. So you'd be keeping the time going with one stick, usually a right stick, but, you know, depends, you know, left-handed drummers the other way around.
Sure.
And the other one would be sweeping on the two and the four and playing a strong accent, you know, buff, 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 and that sort of thing. And we're going to hear a nice example of that from Tommy Benford, who's a slightly lesser-known drummer, but he's playing with someone who's extremely well-known in this example. This is Jelly Roll Morton. And we're going to hear Tommy powering a band along, quite a small band, but they're playing pretty loud, and he's powering it along using brushes, you know, no faffing around with the tips of the brushes. He's absolutely thumping these drums with the brushes, playing this lovely strong backbeat. And when it's behind the piano solo, behind Jelly Roll Morton's piano solo, you can really hear clearly what he's doing with these brushes. Tommy Benford with the Kansas City Stomps.
Yeah, he's really whacking that snare, and that quarter note kind of feel on the upbeat really makes your, like I said, I'm just sitting here bobbing my head, and I love the like the syncopated little, it seems like the little tag, you know, the little tag with the kind of muted cymbal there is faster. Yeah. Like they're doing things quicker and shorter, you know?
Yeah. It's choppy, isn't it?
It's choppy in a good way.
Yeah, in a very good way. It makes you want to dance, which is the whole point. I mean, all of this music was dancing music. Even the slower tempos, there are no really slow tempos, just as there are no really fast tempos in 20s jazz. It's all, you know, there are faster and slower tunes, but it's all meant to be danced, you know, for people to dance to. So it's not going to be extremes of tempo or indeed volume. It's mostly, you know, loudish, because that was the whole point, you know. The bands were just doing in the studio, they were just doing what they would have done on a gig, which was 99 times out of 100 would have been, you know, people dancing. So yeah, he's pounding that backbeat out, isn't he? It's really almost like a rock drummer. It's like Ringo or something, only, you know, 60 years earlier.
But it, like, so I wonder if it's, and you obviously would know this, I wonder if it's because, like, if you did that with a stick, you'd just be cracking. I mean, it would be too loud for the recording. And so if you're using a brush, then you can get away with a little bit more of a real hit on a recording, because it's not so loud. It's not so, you know, cracking.
It may have been that. It may have been that. Or it may have been that he knew that in the arrangement there was going to be a piano solo quite early on, and he thought, I can't be bothered starting off on sticks and changing to brushes. I might just pound it. And then probably using the butt end of the brush to play that cymbal. You mentioned the syncopated cymbal hits there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so we've got, you know, some idea. I mean, called Brushes have been going for a while. That was actually from 1928. But, you know, it's just a nice example that I happen to have on record. If I had more records in better shape, then of course I could have played something earlier, but I just didn't, you know.
It's great.
I'm not the biggest record collector in the world. I've just kind of got what I've got. Okay, so now we're going to come on to another one of these novelty instrument crazes. We've already had the washboard craze of 1923. 1927 really was the hand cymbal craze. Billy Gladstone, who was a great orchestral percussionist in New York, mm-hmm. I think it's been mentioned several times on the podcast already. He originated this idea, I think actually with Rob, you mentioned it briefly, that this idea of a handheld instrument involving two small cymbals that you could strike with a stick and open and close with your other hand to get all kind of interesting syncopated rhythms. He was the first one to, I think he patented it in 1927 and it came out in the Ludwig catalogue there. It's called a Ludwig Gladstone cymbal. But very, very quickly, other companies immediately jumped on it and started marketing them, you know, realizing that drums would sell them. And they were used mostly either for, well, I mean, partly for keeping time, but because the cymbals were quite small in order to make it, you know, portable and able to be held, they couldn't be so loud. So often drummers would use them for solo breaks. We've heard some solo breaks before with Jasper Taylor on the washboard. We're now going to hear, I've mentioned him already, the great Zutty Singleton, the great New Orleans drummer Zutty Singleton playing. Starting off actually a track with some solo breaks on the hand cymbal. And in fact, he's using a small instrument held in each hand. So he's got a slightly larger one in one hand, a slightly smaller one in another hand, and he's playing these syncopated. You'll be able to hear there's two pitches going on. And this is the introduction to Louis Armstrong's record Fireworks from 1927 with Zutty playing the hand cymbals.
Cool. I'm excited to hear this. Here we go. Nice. That was a shorty. That's so cool, though. I mean, it's very still. I mean, 1927. Everyone who's listened to this and knows the drum history stuff knows 1927 is the end of that kind of silent movie thing. It still has a bit of that trap feel, you know, very trappy. So that's awesome.
And I mean, there's a whole article I've written about hand cymbals and actually comparing loads and loads and loads of different records, I should say, as I have done for quite a few different instruments that we've talked about, cymbals and drums and other things, where I've found maybe, I don't know, 30 examples of different drummers playing them in different ways. And not everyone used them in that way, but that's a particularly famous opening to a famous record. So I thought, hey, let's stick that one in.
Totally.
Other drummers who play them, like Chick Webb, one of his first recordings, Dog Bottom, he uses hand cymbals. That's in 1929. And there's loads of other drummers used them. But it seems to last for about a year and a half. And then they all go, fed up with that. And then they chuck them away. And not many records made with it. Because things like hi-hat are starting to come in, which we can talk about maybe in a short while. But yeah, it's quite a short craze. But while it was happening, it's a really, really, really big thing. And all drummers would have been like, oh man, I've got to get one of those hand cymbals.
Nowadays you hear those like I don't want to say like auto tune, or there's these like weird little like sounds that you hear on like pop songs that are around for like the summer or something, you know what I mean? And then it goes like a weird baby crying sound that was in pop like in the 2000s and it's like then it's gone, and it seems similar where it's like everyone's got to have it and then it goes away.
Yeah, Millennial Whoop, that's called, I believe.
Okay.
All those songs that
I
went,
love
oh,
the Millennial
well.
Whoop.
Yeah. But, you know, drummers have always been suckers for, you know, gimmicks. I think we always have.
Oh, yeah.
You know, every decade, you know, the new idea that comes out, the new innovation. Oh, man, I've got to go and get one of those straight down the local shop, you know. Whether it's Power Toms or Fusion Kits or anything, you know, going back as far as you want. So that was just the latest one of those.
Sure.
Another novelty thing that's around at the same time is, I mean, a lot of these things are trends. You know, we've talked about trends for different ways of playing the cymbal, different ways of playing, you know, brushes, snare drum, all these sorts of things. One thing I couldn't really leave out, although it was a complete outlier and he was the only guy who did this. We've already heard from Vic Berton briefly, but because he was a classically trained percussionist and he could play tuned percussion, he could play timpani and all this other stuff, tubular bells, there's an incredible photo of him with, you know, all this equipment set up around, surrounded by this arsenal of gear. He was a specialist in this thing that he called hot timpani, where he would play walking bass lines, solo breaks, and all sorts of stuff on his timps, as well as playing kit. So very briefly, you might need to fade this out because I've left quite a bit of stuff in because he starts off playing a timpani intro, then he goes back to playing this tricky cymbal that we've already heard. Then he plays tom-toms and varying the pitch of the tom-tom by pressing on the head with his, you know, his other stick, like you've heard Krupa and all these other guys do.
Of course, sure.
Then he plays woodblock and all this sort of stuff. But it's just such a bizarre sound. And like I say, he was the only guy who really did it, but it's so fun. And so amazing to hear timpani used in this way. I just thought I can't really not include this. So we'll hear a bit of Vic Berton playing hot timpani with Red Nichols. This is Alabama Stomp, also from 1927. There's that tricky cymbal.
Yeah. On the blocks. Cool.
Yep, back on the blocks.
Nice. A lot of variety.
Nuts, right?
Yeah.
But you see what I mean about how they were keen to vary the texture behind each new soloist.
Exactly. It's sort of
a different texture to play over.
Yeah, it changes it up. I love that timpani intro. I mean, that's just that was hot timpani, if I've ever heard it.
Yeah. So I mean behind Miff Mole, who's the trombone player, behind his solo he's playing cymbal, then behind Red Nichols, who's the cornet player, then he's playing these Chinese tom toms. And like I say, sort of muting them and changing the pitch. So you got the doom, 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 yeah, all that sort of stuff. Then there's an ensemble bit where he played woodblock as you went back on the blocks, and he was. and then that was Jimmie Dorsey playing alto sax towards the end there. He's back on playing chromatic bass lines on the timpani. There's no bass player in that band, so he's playing bass lines. And it's so imaginative. And like I say, he was the only guy who did that because, I mean, who wants to cart pedal timpani around to every who can afford it for starters? Not me, that's for sure.
Seriously.
As far as I'm aware, the only person I've really ever heard do that since is my friend Josh Duffy, who lives in Davenport, Iowa, who's got, you know, he's got all the right gear, he's got some pedal tune timps, and he can do that. But I've never heard anybody else really who's able to replicate it. So
no, that's but that's such a great point, is like just moving this stuff around. I mean, really having a timpani, and you got to think too that this sounds so much different when you're watching it live. And a lot of these really were meant to be for live and for dancing. The point, it was almost like correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, the number one thing was to play these live around at dance halls and in hotels. Number two would be on the recordings, obviously, because it's just not as predominant, right?
Yeah. And I mean, I think a lot of drummers you see with, like Sonny Greer from Ellington's band, you see him with timpani and, you know, they could play them, but they weren't masters in as much as they could retune the timpani as they were going and play, you know, all this sort of really complex lines. They might hit them once or twice per song, you know, where when it said so in the music. But because Burton was such a virtuoso on all these different instruments, he could, you know, he could really do that.
Or John Bonham later.
Oh, John Bonham later. Yeah. A slightly different sort of context. Yeah. But probably the same amount of drinking involved. I think all these guys were, you know, booze hounds. So probably not, not that dissimilar in some ways.
Sure.
So we're going to finish up with, we're getting to the late 20s now. We're going to finish up with looking at really where the music was going towards the end of the decade. Like I say, a lot of this stuff, there were trends going on. And of course, there's radio now and there's, you know, talky film, soundy films coming in. So that's starting to be a thing. And, you know, the spread of music is becoming quicker and quicker so that everyone can see, oh, that's popular. Okay, I'll do that too. Which obviously earlier in the decade, it took more time to spread. So you start to get sort of mainstream trends building up by now. One of these really is what we'd really sort of later on start to refer to as the Chicago style of jazz, where there's quite a few players who did this, you know, Dave Tough, George Wetling, but really, most of all, your mate Gene Krupa, who I know you've had quite a few podcasts with. By this point, he's probably 19 or 20. He's pretty young, but he's just, you know, making his first steps into the professional jazz world, and he's appearing on the scene and doing this stuff incredibly well. He moved to New York in 1928 and started playing with some of the guys actually that we've been hearing, Red Nichols, Miff Mole, and a few of the others. And what Gene really seems to have done that nobody else was doing quite to the same degree at this point was using a four in the bar bass drum and playing time on snare drum and on tom-toms and not really using cymbals much. Okay, he does use a bit of Chinese cymbal for accents, but really, you know, he called it moving the rhythm along on the drums. Mm-hmm. He does this, you know, playing fills and interacting with the front line in a completely different way. We've just heard Burton and the way he played with Nichols and Mole and these, you know, these session guys in New York. Now we're going to hear a bit of Krupa from the year after and the difference that his style of playing has on the band. He starts off, there's no drums during the first half of the clarinet solo. Then we'll hear him come in playing these press rolls, offbeat press rolls, and really driving the band. Then when the ensemble comes in, you can hear he's playing these tom-tom fills and his Chinese tom-tom and the kind of hurly-burly excitement that he's able to generate that's really kind of distinctive in this Chicago style that he had. So this is Shimmy Shaw Wobble with Miff Mole, 1928.
All right, here is Shimmy Shaw Wobble.
Here he comes.
Oh, yeah. Man, that was great.
It's a pumping four-beat bass drum. Yeah.
Yeah, it feels more, it almost feels more modern. There's, You can hear it, but there's, at the beginning of this episode, you said, you know, people should rewind and listen a few times. I feel like if you really do like careful listening, or like, just like you kind of close your eyes and like almost mentally like zoom in on the certain parts, you hear it better. And you just want to go like, turn the drums up, but obviously it's the recording.
Yeah. Turn the crackle down. Yeah.
Less crackle.
I mean, the trouble is there probably are cleaner copies of these records out there that you can find. That's the idea. This is just a starting point. You know, it's what I happen to have on my shelves. But it's almost like one of those, do you remember those magic eye pictures from the 90s when we were kids, and you had to sort of see through the pattern, and then this thing would emerge. It's a little bit like that. After a while, you can sort of almost mentally tune out the crackle, but it is hard the first few times. But you can really hear there he's playing these fills on the tom-toms and a bit of Chinese cymbal. And also, what I didn't mention was the strong accents on beat four. One, two, three, boom, deck, boom. And that is really typical. I mean, you know, throughout the 20s, that's going on, but it's something that, you know, particularly as we get into the swing era, which really that is kind of almost proto-swing, isn't it? You've got all this excitement with an even four beats per bar. You know, it's starting to get towards that. And I think that's, as you say, it sounds modern. That's probably kind of what...
Yeah.
You know, what
modern for
modern.
That, you know what I mean? Yeah. But like, and it's that clarinet that's kind of like, it almost like drunkenly kind of like, like it's just sort of like, it's swingy.
I know exactly what you mean. Yeah. Yeah.
A wobble to go with the name Shimmy Shaw Wobble.
Absolutely. Yeah. It kind of is that, I suppose. So, I mean, of course he's not, you know, it's not like to say everybody was doing this by the late 20s, but the most cutting edge guys, Stan King, I should mention at the same time, Ben Pollack, Ray Bauduc. There are a few other similar guys who come up from, you know, different places in the country, but by the late 20s, they're playing in a very similar way. I just didn't have any good records of them. So, and it's always nice to hear Gene because, you know, he's kind of one of the landmark guys, isn't he? You know, it's nice to hear him in a, like I say, he's probably a late teenager there and already playing with these legends, you know. So, it's a nice illustration of where kind of that music came from.
Oh, man. I mean, this just is so cool to hear. And first off, I just want to thank you for being so prepared and having these kind of chopped and the fades and everything. And I like, it's so much fun to listen like in real time with you and kind of like, and to hear these. But really, the amount of time and effort that you have put into it is just, it means a lot to me. And I'm sure everyone listening is like, you know, is happy to be able to, you know, we're all hearing it together, which is just too cool.
Oh, great. Well, I mean, I love listening to it. So it's been fun just sitting here having a cup of tea and talking to you, really, and listening to it all again. So it's been an absolute pleasure. Yeah, no.
Well, and I want to say, too, so then Nick is going to, I mean, this just flew by. Like, really, this just like absolutely flew by. An hour just completely went away. So what Nick and I are going to do is do a bonus episode, a Patreon bonus episode, where I think it would be neat if we kind of focused more on the gear of like the collapsible bass drum, the snares you've been mentioning, basically going off of your website. If people want to check that out, and usually I do a weekly bonus Patreon episode, go to drumhistorypodcast.com and there's a button for Patreon. On that note, too, why don't we tell people, so Nick, obviously, why don't you read off the website again and tell them how they can get in touch with you and social media and all that great stuff.
Sure. Well, the website is very simple. It's just drumsinthe20s.com. 20 spelt in letters rather than in numbers. So T-W-E-N-T-I-E-S. Drumsinthe20s.com. But if you just search 1920s drums or anything like that, I'm sure it will come up because there's not that many people writing extremely long-winded websites about it. I seem to be in a small little sort of niche on my own there.
Good. Yeah, that's great. No, this is, and again, everyone listening can tell Nick knows his stuff. Gosh, man, that just was so cool to hear this stuff. So what I'm going to do is I will put the song titles. I'll maybe do a little in the description. I'll share Nick's latest project that he did, and then we'll do the link for the website, and then I'll have the names of the songs and just basically copy the information Nick has given to me, and we'll share it there. But yeah, man, this is so cool. I'm so grateful for you for putting this all together. It's just a kind of a brand new type of episode for drum history.
Well, I mean, I don't know. It wasn't any great, you know, effort. It's just like, I'm passionate so much about the way the instruments were used. I think it tells such an interesting story as you know, once you've kind of got an understanding of the way that developments in gear reflected the music and influenced the way the music went, like we say, with all these novelty crazes and stuff. And, you know, why, when I listen to a Louis Armstrong record, is Zutty Singleton not playing drums, but he's making all these weird click clop, you know, sounds with these hand cymbals? Oh, yeah. It's because there was a big craze that started in 1927. You know, so it's kind of, it explains so much of what might be misleading or hard to understand, you know, when you just listen to the music on its own. So hopefully, yeah. It might do something to help people to understand. And that's really one of the reasons why I started the website, because there just wasn't any place where all this information was gathered together in a reasonably coherent way. It was all spread around different books and websites, you know, that you had to find.
Exactly. That's such a good way to look at things too, of like, oh, what was going on at the time? Like, I remember Mark Cooper on an early episode was like kind of like reiterating to me that, like, oh yeah, banjos were like the biggest instrument in America at a certain time. So that's why you heard a lot of banjo, because everyone was obsessed with banjos. You kind of think like, and even clarinet. I mean, you don't hear as much clarinet in pop music today. And it's like, well, that's
no,
it was massive.
That's true. Man. Yeah. I mean, the banjo thing was just because there weren't amplifiers. So if you had to play live, it had to be loud and guitar wasn't going to cut it. So, you know, same with tuba for the bass instrument. And the bass, you know, we heard a bass sax earlier on, because a double bass, you know, boom, 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 you're not going to hear it.
Yeah.
So you have to keep going back and thinking about, yes, but what was the application for this? As you say, it's for dancing, it's for dance halls. Okay, records were made, but most of the time the bands were doing their live show, you know, in a studio.
Yeah. Even in modern recordings, if you have bass being recorded, you typically have to add distortion to it or some sort of interesting technique to make it cut in a recording. So bass has always been a bit of a tricky, you know, thing, but that's bass history.
Yes. Yeah. Surely there's somebody out there doing that. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. all right. Well, Nick, Mr. Nicholas D. Ball, I want to thank you for being on the show. And again, if anyone wants to hear more about this, then check out the Patreon, where you can hear a bonus episode all about the gear. It'll be about 10, 15 minutes, and we'll chat and have a great time. So on that note, Nick, thank you.
It's been a real pleasure, Bart. Thank you.
If you like this podcast, find me on social media at Drum History, and please share, rate, and leave a review. And let me know topics that you would like to learn about in the future. Until next time, keep on learning.